The Senate on Monday also ratified the bicameral conference committee report of a bill expanding the range of benefits and coverage under the current Solo Parents Welfare Act. And we have with us the chairperson of the Senate's contingent at the bicameral conference committee, who is also running for another term in the Senate, Senator Risa Ontiveros. Senator Ontiveros, thank you for joining us today.
Congratulations.
Thank you. It's a happy bill. Alam mo naman siguro, Karen, solo mom din ako, and really a lot of solo parents and our organizations worked with me and my office on pushing this bill. They lobbied for the passage of the bill in both houses. Nag-signature campaign sila in several provinces and cities. Kaya masaya talaga ako, Karen. Pirma na lang ng presidente ang kulang. Magiging batas na talaga ito.
Okay. Sa mga nanunood ngayon sa atin, ang mga solo parents, single mothers, single fathers, dapat pakinggan nila ito. So let's talk about it. First, there are 15 million solo parents in the Philippines, of which it turns out, of course, quite obviously, 95% are women. Yes. But what are the features of this particular bill? Soon to become law. Unang-una, how do you define solo parents in this particular measure?
Okay, yun yung isang importanteng amendment, Karen, na pati yung mga asawa o kapamilya ng mga low and semi-skilled OFWs natin na nasa labas ng Pilipinas for an uninterrupted period of 12 months or more, ituturing na rin solo parents, makakapakinabang sa benepisyong ito. Yung mga legal guardians, adoptive o foster parents, pati yung mga lolo-lola na solong nagpapalaki sa apo nila, makakabenepisyo din sa batas. So these are the additions we are making to those who will be considered as solo parents.
Mm-mm. So halimbawa, hindi ka adoptive parent, mm-hmm, pero may inaalagaan kang bata, let's say naiwan ng kapatid mo, yes, or alam mo yun, ang kamag-anak mo, inihabilin sa'yo, are you covered as a solo parent for that?
You are covered as a family member or relative as long as solo kang nagpapalaki. So kumbaga, tumatayo kang solo parent nung batang iyon. If that is the case, then you will also be covered by this law.
Okay. Then there's also the decrease in the number of months of employment before availment, yes, of the solo parent leave. Can you explain that?
Mm-mm. Currently kasi, Karen, pwede kang gumamit ng 7-day parental leave after 1 year in a job. Ang ginagawa dito sa bill na ito, yung 7 araw na paid leave, kahit 6 months pa lang sa trabaho, yes, pwede mo nang gamitin.
Oo. At kumbaga, hindi yan pwedeng, your boss can't use that against you at work in terms of, you know what, you came in too soon and you're using your solo parent leave.
That's right. Wala
I
nang too soon.
It can't be used against you, yeah.
No, it cannot. Kasi basta may 6 months ka na doon, entitled ka na. And I'm finding, Karen, that more and more bosses are appreciative of this dahil alam nila, you know, taking the view of the large picture, the big picture, kapag mas naalagaan ng maayos yung mga bata, kahit na or lalo na ng mga solo parents, it redounds to the good of the whole society in the long term.
Oh, and I'm curious, does this only cover employees, or what about those who are contractuals? Or I mean, what's the setup there?
Mm-mm. Yung setup sa ngayon, Karen, ha, ay kailangan empleyado. So importante, salamat for mentioning the status of contractuals, dahil lahat naman ng working people, kung solo parent, regardless of employment status, ayun, may solong responsibilidad para sa bata and dapat makapakinabang din. So that's another area of social reform we're still working on, the security of tenure, the labor rights of all working people. Pero may iba't ibang mga benepisyo, particular sa solo parents na nandito sa bill, and overall I hope it will add to the welfare and the happiness of solo parents throughout our economy.
Okay. And of course, there's the provision of 1,000 pesos
yes.
for minimum wage earning solo parents. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about this in detail. Paano nila ito makukuha? Kada buwan ba ito? Paanong sistema?
Kada buwan po yan, Karen, ang sistema ay basta't kumikita ng minimum wage at pababa, entitled doon sa monthly cash assistance na 1,000 pesos kada uh-oh. Solo parent.
So that's baga technically 12,000 a year.
12,000 a year, uh-oh. That's right, Karen. Basta't minimum wage earner or even less.
Okay, but have you done the math in terms of how many might avail of 12,000 a year? We have the money for that.
Yes, and we actually have the assurance from the Department of Finance itself dahil ito yung tinanggap nilang compromise amendment sa current Solo Parents Welfare Act. Kapalit, nung una sanang gustong isulong, Karen, ng both houses, yung House of Reps at kami sa Senate, a very big package of discounts sa malawak na range ng mga produkto at serbisyo para sa solo parents. Sinabi ng DOF, committee hearings pa lang, ayaw nila yon dahil hindi kakayanin. So in the back and forth between kami ng House at Senate on the one end and on the other end yung DOF, ito yung naabot naming kompromiso. So that means we have DOF's confidence as well na kayang pondohan ito ng ating gobyerno.
Oo. And I'm curious, how will it work? I mean, with the 3 P's, no, the 4 P's rather,
yes.
You are registered as a beneficiary and it's either deposited to you specifically into an account and there are conditions that come with it, right?
Yes,
pero
right.
Paano po ito? Alam ko wala pang IRR, pero ano yon? Ang DSWD ba ang magdi-distribute? Nakarehistro ka ba sa LGU? Paano yun, Senator?
Ang DSWD din, tama Karen, ang mag-award nito buwan-buwan and importante, essential na partner ang LGUs para siguruhin na lahat ng qualified solo parents na minimum wage earner pababa ay makapakinabang dito at sila lang, walang iba. So as for other social protection programs, merong ganong identification of the beneficiary participants at saka checks and balances, no, na walang fraud at walang wastage o leakage na mangyayari.
Mm-mm. So let's say, matanong ko lang, no, problema to sa ano eh, sa in several socio-economic classes. Ganito, sasabihin, hindi na ako binalikan ng asawa ko. Hindi naman siya tumutulong sa panggastos. But technically, under the law, the mother is still married. Therefore, not defining her as a solo parent, but in action is a solo parent.
Right. Well, in those cases, Karen, kaya importante yung papel ng LGU, halimbawa barangay. DSWD pa rin ang may last touch, pero matimbang yung input ng LGU, halimbawa nung barangay captain, na talagang civil status notwithstanding, solong tumatay yung magulang itong nanay, in this example, sa kanyang mga anak. Solo siyang nagpapalaki sa mga bata, walang child support mula sa kanyang asawa o dati. Ating asawa.
Okay. Now there's also the increase in the age ceiling of the child of the solo parent for the availment of benefits. Can you explain that? It's supposed to align with a K-12 system.
Exactly.
What does that mean?
Well, dahil nga sa K-12, Karen, na pinahaba, no, yung pag-aaral ng ating mga anak, so may karapatan pa rin sa mga benepisyo ang solo parents hanggang tumuntong yung mga dependents, yung mga anak ng 22 years old. Dati nakapeg sa 18 kasi at 18 posibleng tapos na sa pag-aaral. Pero ngayon siguradong at 22 malamang nag-aaral pa or patapos pa lang. So this is a good example, yung pag-align natin ng mga bagong batas sa mga existing so that the overall policy framework is consistent. No, one with the other.
Oo. And not only that, talk about there's also educational scholarships
yes.
for eligible children. I mean, clearly, it's really expanded to benefit both the child and the solo parent.
Tama yun, Karen. Yung scholarship programs, trainings mula sa DepEd, CHED, at pati TESDA ay maaaring i-avail. So talagang when we pass a law like this, tinitingnan natin yung iba't ibang areas ng social protection and how they can, also consistent with already existing laws, really benefit the stakeholders. In this case, yung solo parents at yung mga anak din.
Are you planning at some point, what makes the PWD discount quite effective is there's a card, right? And you can really feel it when you go to drugstores, right? So ang tanong ko, are you planning in the future considering, look, you are also offering, based on your law, a 10% discount for specific medicines for low-income solo parents, children 6 years old and below, priority in low-cost housing, field health coverage. Are you planning like I'm a single parent card?
In fact, in the near future, Karen, posibleng yun ay kasamang maisulat sa implementing rules and regulations for easier identification at for easier availment of the different benefits. Lalo na nga po para sa mga fellow solo parents ko na minimum wage earners and below, and para sa lahat naming solo parents na hindi lang minimum wage earners ay automatic may PhilHealth coverage.
Okay. All right. So clearly this is before the 18th Congress closes, you'd consider this as one of the victories, especially for you. But let's go to the other pending measures, Senator. What else is left? What will make it? What won't make it? I mean, well, clearly the Department of Disaster Resilience, the Senate President said that won't make it.
Posibleng hindi eh. Actually, all of us, Karen, members of the Senate, nagmamadali that in these next 2 weeks, we just have, five session days left. Tapusin namin lahat ng kaya naming tapusin. Sa shop ko, ang pending pa rin ay continuing interpellation ng foundling bill. Tapos yung pagpasa ng parental effectiveness bill, and then just waiting on the action of the House, hoping pa rin talaga na maipasa yung anti-OSAEC or anti-online sexual abuse and exploitation of children bill. So those are some
will
of
that make it? What do you think?
I'm really praying it will make it, Karen, kasi alam ko na yung counterpart ko sa House, si Chair Cheryl Deloso, also various of the deputy speakers, including another Cabaro, fellow woman leader, Deputy Speaker Bernadette Herrera, are really hoping and also working on being able to pass this. At marami sa House, Karen, ay mga magulang din at gustong protektahan yung ating mga anak sa OSAEC. So I have high hopes. I'm holding on to that hope na maipasa pa rin ngayong kongresong ito.
All right. Now, you are number 8. There was a survey, we were talking off air, that begged you, let's put it to 8 to 12, but you were in the top 12 in this particular Senate race. I mean, you're seeing... Senator Risa, frankly, that candidates now have the option not to attend debates. I mean, it was never compulsory.
No.
But remember, I would have to say in the 2016 elections, you had candidates, I mean, even then Mayor Duterte attended all the debates, right?
Right.
But then times have changed. Do you feel it's time to make that compulsory for candidates running for higher office?
I think, Karen, hindi kalabisan kung gawin nilang compulsory para sa lahat namin. I mean, I think obligasyon namin to attend, participate in such debates, interviews. People actually look forward to them. At pagkakataon namin to present our track record and lay down our platform, dun kami mas nakikilala. So I think, you know, lahat kaming mga kandidato, we really should, kahit hindi pa gawing compulsory yan, we really should show up and step up to such debates and interviews as well.
Okay, your take on former Senator Bongbong Marcos refusing to attend a presidential interview hosted by Jessica Soho and calling her biased. And in last night's 1PH interview on Channel 5, when he was asked to define what's biased, he said anti-Marcos.
Oh, gosh. Well, you know, just for the record, like you, Karen, I think that Ms. Jessica is definitely a very professional, unbiased, fair interviewer. Kaya hindi ko na-appreciate yung ganyang klaseng pagpuna sa kanya or to any of you for that matter na nakikita kong you're simply trying to pose the right questions to us, mga kandidato, mga partido, for the benefit of your audiences. At mahirap namang sabihing unbiased is not anti this or that, or unbiased is pro this or that. Kasi the very essence of being unbiased is being open to or trying to open up the conversation at yung kaisipan naming lahat ng mga audiences ninyo to all perspectives, to all issues, and to be open to critical debate.
So doesn't he have a point? I mean, just when Mr. Marcos says, how do you define bias? Anti-Marcos. Because if you're anti something, doesn't that make you biased? I mean, it's a very good discussion, and hearing his definition of bias is quite surprising for many journalists. But what do you think of that definition of bias?
I think journalists, like any citizen, meron kayong sariling opinion. You may have your own philosophies, even politics and life. Pero ang nakikita ko sa karamihan ninyo, you exercise that kind of professionalism na kahit, you know, kaming mga kakandidato, mga partido namin, kung imbitahin kami ng somebody we know prefers one philosophy or other in life, in governance. Pero nakikita namin na professional, tulad mo, tulad ni Ms. Jessica, tulad ng marami pang iba, we should show up. And going beyond the interviewer, yung pang pag-imbita ninyo sa amin sa mga debate at interview, precisely is our chance to speak with the citizens and the voters. So I don't think we should shy away from such invitations, Karen.
Mm-mm. And I'm asking this only because, well, of course, you have former Senator Bongbong Marcos, who is the front runner at this point. Latest surveys peg him at more than 60%. And in yesterday's interview, he said he is not in favor of releasing the SAL-N just as easily. I mean, considering there was a battle for the FOI bill that many have struggled with in the lower house, Mr. Marcos has said, because it can be used for politics, which he does have a point, but he said he'd only agree to it if, let's say, it's needed in particular cases. So what do you make of the general stand of the possible next president of the Philippines saying he does not agree to releasing the SAL-N? You know, even to journalists, I mean, not as easily in terms of just getting information.
Tingin ko, Karen, lahat kaming kakandidato at mga partido namin, dapat we adopt a more expansive, liberal, we have liberality rather than limitation, precisely because of that spirit of freedom of information. At sa ganung, again, big picture, yung SAL-N is one of the most important documents, report of us working in government to the citizenry para masingil nila yung accountability sa amin. Do our assets show that we are trying to live a simple lifestyle ayon sa ethics ng mga government officials and employees? Yung SAL-N ba namin pinapakita na wala kaming liabilities that would hinder or cripple us from carrying out our public duties? Yung SAL-N ba namin nagpapakita na wala kaming posibleng conflict of interest in doing our work dahil sa economic standing namin? So mas mabuti, palagay ko, habang nagtatrabaho kami sa gobyerno, habang magpepresenta kami para magtrabaho ulit sa gobyerno, na we should be more open rather than closed or limited in terms of allowing access sa mga dokumento na mismong konstitusyon sinasabing dapat handa kaming ibigay.
Okay. Now, Another presidential candidate, Manila Mayor Isko Moreno, revealed that he had an unspent 50 million pesos during the campaign when he ran for the Senate. He kept it but paid his income taxes, and netizens had different opinions about that. Now you run.
Yes.
And I'm curious, what do you think of politicians keeping what we call excess donations? What should be done with them? What do you do with yours?
Oh, I was just about to say that I can't speak from experience kasi never ako nagkaroon ng excess campaign funds after any of my party Akbayan's previous campaigns or my own Senate campaigns. Pero until the BIR, for example, and the COMELEC should say na dapat kung may sobra ay mas ganito ang iginawa rather than keeping it, though paying taxes on it, then I can't propose an alternative right now. Ang naiisip ko, Karen, pagdating sa campaign funds ay kasunod nung earlier campaign or rather electoral reform laws like the party list law, the automated election law, of course the overseas absentee voting law. We need many more electoral reform bills. For example, precisely on campaign finance reform. Na yun would... Oh. Diba, give a state subsidy through the COMELEC to each candidate and party depending on the number of votes they got in the previous election. Well, that's one model mula sa ibang bansa. Tapos, kung ano yung ibinigay na public funds, pwede mag-raise ng counterpart private donations only to that level as well. And then pagkatapos ng kampanya, of course, everybody makes their sauce report to the COMELEC. Isang paraan palagay ko, Karen, that proven in more developed democracies and political systems, will in fact effectively control the quite, you know, to be blunt, crazy campaign spending we see like ours. Well,
because that was a revelation to many. Well, you have at least Manila Mayor Isko Moreno admitting it publicly, but it was a revelation to many on Twitter and on Facebook. Now, if somebody who was running for senator had an excess of 50 million, they started to ask, paano pa yun tumatakbong vice-presidente? Paano pa yun tumatakbong presidente? So then you had netizens asking, is this why many people want to run for public office? Because you then get to earn extra income. All you need to do is not spend what's been given to you, which was meant for you to spend during the campaign. So it doesn't make politicians really look good. Not to say that Mayor Isko did anything particularly wrong under the law, but it was a revelation to many netizens.
And the fact na revelation siya, Karen, and by the tone of your narration, it was maybe very surprising or even a bit shocking for some netizens, and doesn't, sabi mo nga, doesn't reflect well on us who's working in government. Then all the more, kailangan natin ng mga further electoral reforms, in particular campaign finance reform, to remove that perception or even the reality na hindi maganda ang dating. And precisely, if we have campaign finance reform, isa-set yung stage for further financial reform even during the terms of office of government officials. So overall, I think makakadagdag lang dun sa kampanya natin for transparency and accountability, even against graft and corruption or outright plunder for that matter.
Okay. Last word, Senator Risa. I know that you still, I think you still have 4 days, right? Four or five sessions.
Today, tomorrow, until we extended next session week to Thursday para lang matapos ang mas maraming maitatapos namin.
All right. Huling habilin po, anong nais yung sabihin?
Salamat, Karen. I really hope that together with my colleagues in the Senate, I can push pass more of my Healthy Buhay at Hanap Buhay bills in this 18th Congress. And I'm hoping and praying and preparing hard to be able to continue to work on that legislative and direct services agenda in the following Congress, especially on health measures, economic measures with that gender lens. And of course, continue those services like the Healthy Healthy Pinas Mobile Clinic, and also relief efforts after disaster. Salamat, Karen, and stay healthy.
All right. Thank you so much, Senator Risa Ontivero. Stay healthy too, ma'am.